Hello, this is Austin Hetzler, the pastor of Christ the Rock Church of Elyria, Ohio. We at Christ the Rock are humbled and grateful to get to be a part of your sanctification today as you watch or listen to this sermon. But at the same time, we want to encourage you to be a member of a good local church and not to allow online sermons to replace the local church and to benefit from the life of that church and to give your spiritual gifts back to that church. Having said that, our website is www.christrockchurch.com. If you go there, you can find sermons, blogs, and other resources, as well as our location and service times. You can also listen to the sermons on Bible Thumping Wingnut, Podbean, iTunes, Google Play Music, iHeartRadio, and other podcast catchers. We also invite and encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube station. You can look it up, or you can use the link to it that's found on our website. I, along with a membership of Christ the Rock Church, sincerely pray that this sermon will be a blessing. Heavenly Father, we praise your name for the wonders of your eternal plan with respect to our salvation, to bring glory to yourself. We praise your name for the fact that we have an intercessor, that we are not going to be in a judgment without an advocate. We have been advocated for in the greatest way possible, and we continue to be advocated for as Christ ever lives to make intercession for us. He is bringing our petitions, our concerns to you as our great high priest. We are so grateful for this. What a wonder. And none other than the Messiah himself would stand up on our behalf and pray for us. Lord, I pray that you give us grace in this time as we consider these things. We pray for a powerful movement of the Spirit. We pray that the result of this would be great joy. And we pray that that joy would translate into an even greater earnestness to serve you in this life. We praise you and we thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen. This afternoon, we're going to conclude our exposition of the great high priestly prayer of Jesus in John 17. Everything in this prayer thus far has been foundational to that which precedes it, and that will remain true through its completion. Jesus first, if you recall, prays for himself because the glory of God and our salvation is bound up and contingent upon the success of his passion and beyond his death, his resurrection, and his ascension. His prayer for his success in these matters then leads into his prayer for his 11 men. They are themselves redeemed by the faith that is realized in his passion, and their forthcoming apostolic ministry is not without its success. After all, what good is a Christian apostle if you've got a dead Christ? An apostle is one who is sent out. You can't be sent out by a corpse. And then, what good are Christian apostles without Christian saints that have been converted through their ministries? Christ is going to build his church. He's been clear about that. The apostles are foundational, though, to that building. And thus, verse 20 begins the final leg of this logical progression. With us, do not ask on behalf of these alone, but for those also who believe in me through their word. And this final leg of the sequence, which directly speaks of you and me and of the saints of all time post the apostolic age, we will enter into that now, straight away. We're going to enumerate our final study of what remains of John 17 into points, beginning first off with everything that Jesus prayed for his 11, he also prayed for you, and everything he prayed with respect to himself, the Father, and by inference, the Spirit, also pertains to you. Let me say that one more time. Everything that Jesus prayed for his 11, he also prayed for you, and everything he prayed with respect to himself, the Father, and by inference, the Spirit, also pertains to you. Now, because this is not the first time that I've stated this fact, we are simply going to review here, but this review is necessary because it is foundational to the other elements in this study. So to begin our brief review, we will start with what's been taught about God and his Christ in this great prayer. God's glory is, of course, primary in salvation and, in fact, all things, and is thus primary in this prayer. The glory of God is what the fabric of the high priestly prayer is comprised of, as well as it is the thread that runs all the way through it to the very end. Starting in verse 1 and skimming, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Verse 4, I glorified you on the earth, having accomplished the work which you have given me to do. Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. Verse 10, all things that are mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And then on into our text for today, and things we have not yet covered. Verse 22, the glory which you have given me, I have given to them. Verse 24, Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory which you have given me. And we skimmed there not because those are the only passages that pertain to the glory of God. It all does. I just wanted to highlight that which was most germane. Now, once again, the salvation of man is great. Let it be shouted from the mountaintops that Christ saves sinners. But as great as that message is, the salvation of man serves a greater end, and indeed a far greater end. And that is to demonstrate the glory or the praiseworthiness of the God who did the saving. Now, the second issue then that we need to be reminded of is that God is sovereign, the Father, and so is his Son. Verse 2, of the Father, the Son says, even as you, Father, gave him, the Son, referring to himself in the third person, authority over all flesh. Now, only God can possess all authority, yeah? Sovereign rule. And yet both Father and Son have all authority together. And this is no blasphemy because of verses 10 and 11. All things that are mine are yours, and yours are mine. Again, as a matter of volume, you have to possess the same volume in order to be able to contain all that is of another entity. In this case, you have this being true with the first person of the Trinity and the second person of the Trinity. And I have been glorified in them. He goes on to say, I am no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world, and I come to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, the name which you have given me, and that name is Yahweh, the ever-living one, never beginning, always being. They are God. Verse 5 also says, now, Father, glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had with you before the world was. Next, by way of reminder, every Christian assents to all of these cardinal truths, or else they are not Christians. Verse 3, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Here I will simply stress knowledge. Every true believer has been illuminated by the Holy Spirit of God with a correct and proper understanding of who Christ is, of who their Savior is. They either know him as the Son or they don't know him at all. They also have an accurate understanding fundamentally of how he saves, and that is by grace through the finished work on the cross. But being that Christianity is no mere intellectual assent, these truths inform as they also transform those who are actually being saved. And Christ acknowledges this inevitability of change in the true believer. Verses 6 through 14, skimming. I have manifested your name to the men whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Verse 8, the words which you gave me, I gave to them, and they received them, and truly understood that I came forth from you, and they believed that you sent me. Verse 14, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world. They are very much distinct, even as I am not of the world. And then finally, by way of remembrance, because God cannot die, neither can the life that he gives. And therefore, we are perfectly and eternally kept in holiness. Verses 11 through 15, skimming, I am no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world, and I come to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name. Verse 12, while I was with them, I was keeping them in your name, which you have given me. Verse 15, I do not ask you to take them out of the world, but to keep them from the evil one. Once again, our prayers are petitions made by finite beings who do not know tomorrow and what it will hold. Christ's prayers are confirmations of that which certainly will be. And we know that we, along with the 11, then, are equally cared for by all that has preceded verse 20 because of verse 20, which is, again, I do not ask on behalf of these alone, but for those also who believe in me through their word. And one of the lessons, and this was referenced in the prayer of praise this afternoon, that is profound, that is derived from this text and this great reality in verse 20, is that there are Christians with different purposes. Indeed, we all have different purposes. Not all of us are apostles. There were the apostles, and then there was everybody else. But although we have different purposes, and we will be used by God to greater or lesser degree in the building of the kingdom of Christ, there are not Christians with different value. There are not Christians, then, who receive lesser care from their Lord. It is true that Christ ever lives to pray for you as an individual, but he never prays for you on the basis of your individual performance. He never prays better for some better Christian. He never prays with lesser concern for some lesser Christian, because that's not the way that any of this works. I wasn't foundational to the development of the church in the way that Peter was. He received the keys to the kingdom, for crying out loud. And he was used to open the kingdom to the Gentiles and to other categories of believer. And yet, here is Jesus praying for Peter the same way that he's praying for me. Praying for me the same way that he's praying for Peter. I have not received a lesser intercession from the Lord Jesus Christ than the men whom he founded his church upon in the first place, in the first century, and neither have you, Christian. He has interceded for you in exactly the same way. The 30-fold Christian is loved and prayed for just the same as the 60-fold, and just the same as the 100-fold. The quality of Christ's intercession reflects his excellencies. It does not reflect your failures. It does not even reflect your successes. You've got to get that right. Otherwise, you spin down into and degenerate into a self-righteous concept of the Christian faith. There are little children who are converted to Christ every day. And sometimes, horribly, they are taken from their parents at a very, very young age after having been converted. If that little child has been converted for 12 months, has produced nothing but to gospel their little siblings to the best of their ability and the best that they can according to their level of knowledge, they have received the same kind of prayer as the man through whom thousands are converted. That is the way the Christian faith works. It is a performance-based religion, but that performance is of Christ and Christ alone. Our second point this afternoon is that Christians are united in and by orthodoxy and orthopraxy. And that simply means orthodoxy is a correct understanding of who God is, what he requires. Orthopraxy is simply living in a way that is consistent with the teachings and commands of the Bible. This goes to verses 20 through 23. I do not ask on behalf of these alone, but for those also who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. The glory which you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, just as we are one, I in them, and you in me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me, and love them, even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory which you have given me. For you loved me before the foundation of the world. And these verses are the Everest of Christian unity. This is the description of the unity of that beautiful body of Christ of which Paul so eloquently wrote. And a body is not a patchwork of parts. A body is grown by way of cell division. That is the nature and the extent of our unity. It is the most intimate that is possible. And John 17 is quoted constantly with reference to Christian unity. And if anything, it should be quoted all the more. Shout it from the rooftops. Shout it from the mountaintops. Let it be heard by everyone. However, This passage is more often quoted in a way that undermines its true meaning than in a manner that is consistent with its true meaning. And we have happened then upon one of the most abused passages in all of Scripture. Perhaps John 3:16 is the most abused, but this certainly ranks up there in those that are, at the top of the list. Let me ask you, what is the common intention of those who quote this passage? Is it perhaps to rebuke those who have any meaningful standard for doctrine or practice? I think it is. You won't include so-and-so as a brother or a sister on the basis of what they believe or what they practice. Jesus prayed for our unity. And yet, without taking you right back through all that this passage teaches us about us and God, those who are united in Christ are defined by an accurate knowledge of Him and obedience to Him. As we've said numerous times, Christianity really isn't this confusing enigma. It's pretty simple. You believe what Jesus said, and you live based upon it. And to divorce the unity of verses 20 through 23 from the biblical orthodoxy and orthopraxy found in the rest of this prayer is to intentionally bastardize the text. That is, assuming that you've actually read the rest of the text, which is indeed an assumption for many people. But if you have read the text, you're doing this on purpose, twisting this to include in Christ's kingdom the son and the daughters of the evil one of verse 15. This is a call for uniting to Satan through the twisting of this passage. And what these false unifiers most commonly do is call you unloving if you insist upon a Christian unity that is actually based upon the teachings of Jesus. That, friends, is emotional manipulation. It is very intentional. The aim of it is to trick you into being unfaithful. It is to trick you into believing that you have not honored and are not honoring that command to love one another, when in reality, they've just misdefined who one another actually consists of. You can't be ignorant to this device of the devil. It is far too common. It happens all the time, so you've got to get hip to it, and you've got to make sure that your first love is intact. And if your first love is intact, then that's going to take care of the rest, because you're not going to let people malign the character of your Lord if indeed you love Him more than you love anybody else. And if you love Him properly, you will love those who truly belong to Him. So that then is the way that this passage is commonly twisted. And I'd have been remiss to not raise that because it is so common again. However, we'd miss a great jewel if we simply emphasize the misapplication of this concept, because Christianity is the greatest kind of unity that exists in the human experience, and not by a small margin. It is a spiritual unity. It is experienced in the natural realm, but it transcends the natural realm and any kind of unity that is merely natural. With respect to this, Jesus said, Matthew 10:34-39, "Do not think that I came to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I came to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a man's enemies will be the members of his household. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who has found his life will lose it, and he who has lost his life for my sake will find it. So worthy is the unity that we have with Christ and with his people on account of him, that we will count all other relationships loss for the sake of keeping that and clinging to him and his people as well." Also, Matthew 12:49-50, stretching out his hand toward his disciples, he said, "Behold my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father who is in heaven, he is my brother and my sister and my mother." The unity of John 17 comes at a price. And that's the price. This is unity by division. To be united with Christ is to be opposed to all who are opposed to him, even if they are in your own household, even if they are your parents, your siblings, or yes, your children. And we should be honest about the fact that that sacrifice is profound. Because in the human experience, there is no greater unity in the purely natural than that which is experienced by members of the same biological family. However, you should also be honest about the fact that even if you were not separated from your family by your faith, many of us would be separated from them because of sin, either their sin or ours. In a fallen world, family structures fracture all the time and dissolve all the time. You probably think of more families that has happened to than you can think of families that have stayed totally and entirely intact and totally functional. And thus, even the greatest sphere of natural unity in a fallen world, which is the family, is naturally fraught with division. But here is the beauty of Christian unity. The family of God is indissoluble. It is indivisible. Jesus didn't separate families with a sword because he was cruel. Jesus separated us from those who now hate us on account of him to then bring us into the family of God and give us the gift of eternal siblings and eternal parents and children in the faith. And we can all testify to the excellencies of this unity and the fact that they far excel anything in the natural realm. Whatever the Lord takes away, that which he replaces it with is far better. And so if you hear about a broad, pervasive animosity in the family of God, don't you dare believe it. It's not true. 1 John 4:7, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. It's really that simple, says John. If you are born of the Father, because you are born of the Father, you will love the other siblings that have been born into the same family with you because of your first and primary love that keeps you connected to each other. This is a certainty. And this is the nature of this unity. It is love. Now, there are many bonds of unity in the natural world. Families are united by biology. We mentioned that already in brief. Soldiers, too, are united in a common pursuit of either conquest or defense. Employees are united in a common pursuit of profit. Shareholders, the same is true. I was a contractor for many years. I'd be hired to perform a particular task on a greater project. Other contractors were hired for the same project. In a sense, I was united with them all because we all worked for the completion of this same structure. There are many causes and kinds of unity in the human experience, but what unites the family of God is distinct entirely from them all. What unites us is love, and it is not some fallen, corrupt, corruptible love. We are united by the very love of God and in the very love of God. And it must be understood that this loving unity is eternally enduring. And this is another aspect of something that we've already discussed, which is that of our being kept by the Father. Going back to verse 11, Holy Father, keep them in your name, the name which you have given me, that they may be one just as we are. Again, name equals character. And according to the Apostle John in his first epistle, love is not merely an action of God. It is the character of God. It is an attribute of God, fundamental to who he is. Now, you and I are individuals, but again, this is a corporate prayer that our Lord is praying. Thus, individual souls of the elect are in view, but so is the collective, and primarily. Remember when we went through and noted all the uses of terms that denote plurality? They, them, and the like? That's who's in view here. So all the people of God, then, are being kept together, united in love and by love. The shepherd knows all his sheep by name, doesn't he? But he also keeps all his sheep in the same flock, and thus they neither stray from him, nor do they stray from each other. Let it be understood then that Christian disunity is an oxymoron. It is a contradiction in terms. And nevertheless, Christian disunity is something that we hear about all the time. And from whom? What kind of person do we most commonly hear about divisions within the church? From unbelievers. And there are a couple things that escape their notice. First of all, they do not account for the concept of false churches, which are very, very common. And so, of course, you will have disunity in that thing because there is no bond of the spirit there. They also do not account for wheat cohabitating the same field as tares. They do not account for the false convert who's been sown into the legitimate church of Christ. Therefore, when they see that church have divisions on the basis of having to deal with people like that, they think it's a lack of unity, when in reality, it's an expression of unity. It is the people of God coalescing to honor God by putting out of their ranks the leaven. And the same is true on a macro level as well. Was what happened in the Methodist denomination between the African Synod and the American Synod a lack of Christian unity? No, that was Christian unity. That's what that looks like. The Americans said, we will accept homosexuality into the church, and the Africans, praise the Lord, said, no, we won't. That was unity. Because no believer would bring that in. And so the children of God united against the children of Satan. Now, there are functional divides in the body of Christ on earth. Okay, paedobaptism versus credo. Baptism is one of those. Infant baptism versus believer's baptism. This is what separates us from the Presbyterians. Those divisions are real and they only exist because of sin. But what unites us is far greater than what divides us. We are still brothers and sisters in Christ. Therefore, this kind of unity is still intact. I have profound love for Pastor Wang Yi. Okay, does baptism matter? Does mode of baptism matter? Yeah, but that man's suffering for the Lord. I would suffer alongside of him. I would call him a brother. I would pray for him as a brother, and I do. And I will be with him forever. And we will both be free then. One of the greatest benefits of persecution, of which we are seeing in many places around the world now, we're starting to see here, is that you have those who really are Christ come together during these times. We get better all of a sudden at discerning the tertiary from the primary, and this is something that you need to do. Does mode of baptism matter? Yeah, it does. Does it matter as much as a proper understanding of justification? No, of course it does not. Or of regeneration? No, of course it does not. Now, it is possible for Christians to not be diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, per Ephesians 4:3. And I'll be honest about that, I'll tell you the truth about that, and I don't want you to misunderstand what I'm saying. But we are not marked by this kind of disunity. To quote John once more, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God." That is the disposition that is definitional of our character. We will sin at times by creating disunity as we sin in many other ways. But if we belong to Jesus, we will repent. And then very often through this repentance, there is a kind of greater unity than ever existed before. You go to a brother or sister, you point this out, they repent, and then you are drawn together in a greater way because you have had that experience and you are used by the Lord to grow them in the faith. Now, as I conclude this thought, I recognize that all of us who are of age have known the pain of seeing our friendships or families destroyed. Pillars of human existence that have failed for us, and it has caused tremendous damage and pain. What I want to leave you with, Christian, is that this will never happen in the family of God. Not ever. This foundation is made of something far stronger than granite. It will never crack. If you are our brother and sister, you will be our brother and sister forever. There are no divides here. There is no divorce coming that will separate us. We are bound together by the blood of Jesus. It will never be dissolved. Third point this afternoon is our unity is a witness to the world. Verses 22 through 23. The glory which you have given me, I have given to them, so that they may be one, just as we are one, I and them and you and me, that they may be perfected in unity, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them, even as you have loved me. Our loving unity with a legitimate household of faith is, according to Jesus, the greatest apologetic that we as Christians have. It is the greatest defense, then, of the faith that we can make to love one another. John 13:35, by this all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. It is this unity manifest in love that the world, or by which the world knows that verse 23, the Father sent the Son and loved his people, even as the Father has loved the Son. That is what they learn from us as they see us love each other. The unbeliever cannot discern proper doctrine because they are dead in their trespasses and sins. And even if they do discern it intellectually, it makes no mark upon their souls and in no way manifests in their behavior. Now we must preach proper doctrine to them because it is through that that the Spirit moves in the souls of the elect and converts them. But without that work, they cannot see it. They cannot understand its value. But what the unbeliever can discern is the vast unexplainable love of the genuine Christian for other genuine Christians. And this observation can and often has led them to saving faith. I think you know people like this. People who didn't really have a deep understanding of the doctrines of the faith, but man, they knew that what was happening in the people of God was something they could not account for. When the believer manifests a strong desire to gather together with the saints, they testify to any in the world who see that the Father really did send the Son and loved his people, even as the Father has loved the Son. When the believer sacrificially and joyfully gives their time and their resources to the household of faith, they testify to any in the world who see that the Father really did send the Son and loved his people, even as the Father has loved the Son. Why do we want to be with the people of God so often? Why do we give so much of ourselves to them? Why are we willing to center our lives around them? Because the Father really did send the Son and loved his people, even as the Father has loved the Son. And this grand reality, brother, sister, Christian, is communicated to the world as we demonstrate a loving unity they cannot account for by any other explanation than, hey man, that has got to be supernatural. And I have seen the kinds of love that exist in the natural sphere, and this is not that. There are many converts who the Spirit drew to Christ through the intoxicating aroma of Christ-like brotherly love. This is why, as much as you can melt worlds, do it. Okay, if you've got a work friend, we have a church event, this has always been understood. Let me say it to you again. We have a church event, you have a work friend who's not a convert, you don't have to ask me if you can bring them. Bring them. Blend those worlds together. If you have a family member who is unconverted, blend those worlds together. Give them an opportunity to see the love of the body, the love of the brethren, because it is unlike anything they will ever see in the natural realm, and it is what God so often uses to bring people to faith. Notice also the nature of the love that we are receiving and manifesting. Verse 23, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you have loved me. Oi! Brace yourself for that. You may want to look at that one more time. Let's do that. So that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you have loved me. How does God love you, Christian? No, not that way. Oh yes, that way. The same way that he loves Christ. That is how he loves us. And as impossible as this is, it cannot be any other way. Let me explain this to you. God is love. We've already covered that. It's fundamental to his being, not merely an action, but an attribute. And thus to say that there is a qualitative difference in the expression of the love of God when that love is expressed in the covenant would mean a qualitative difference in his character. He would not then be able to lessen the degree of his love without demeaning the nature of his being. God is also infinite, and his love is consistent with his nature. Therefore, as a matter of his nature, his love must always be infinite. His love is derivative of his being, thus he cannot love less than what he is. God is also perfect. Therefore, he cannot love in a manner that is somehow imperfect, and for love to be lesser is for love to be imperfect. God is not capable of such imperfection. And finally, and here is the crux of the matter, God loves you as Christ, Christian, because he loves you through Christ. To love the redeemed of Christ less than Christ would be to demean the character of Christ and the work also of Christ on your behalf. We are born again of his blood and born again according to his nature, and that is what God is loving. He is loving the Jesus that has been born in you. This is why when we're speaking of inter-Trinitarian love versus God's love for believers, it gets a little sticky. Welcome to the difficulty of being a theologian. You have to define terms in a way that isn't heretical. Sometimes it gets hard. And so when I went through this, I didn't speak in terms of quantitative or qualitative differences in the way that God loves himself and the way that God loves believers. I spoke in terms, or differentiated in the sense of primary versus secondary, if you remember that. Because clearly there is a difference between the relationship of the Son and the Father. I mean, this is what the Gospel of John has highlighted, a vast difference. John himself differentiates the Son from the adopted sons through the use of different terms, huios for Jesus, technons for us. We are different. That love has always been and always been active. Clearly they are disposed differently to each other than they are to us. Their mutual love is based upon their sameness of being. They know each other as only they can know each other, as three persons of the same being. However, as earth-shattering as this is, the Father neither loves Jesus more than you nor better than you, Christian. Rather, because Christ was treated by God as you should have been on that cross, you are treated by God as Christ is. That is the nature of Christian grace. There is a double imputation. You gave something to Jesus when he was on that cross too. It was all of your sin and all of your shame and all of your guilt. And what he gave you was the right to be called a son of God, which means that when God sees you, he sees you as Christ. Christ gave you in response to your filth his very righteousness and his standing before the Lord. And point number four this afternoon, and this is our final point. Christians were made to see the glory of God as one united people forever. Christians were made to see the glory of God as one united people forever. Verse 24, Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory which you have given me. For you loved me before the foundation of the world. Now what glory is it that Jesus wants us to see? Verse 5, the glory which he had with the Father before the world was. That glory. So then where is the venue that this great display of the ultimate revelation of the Son's glory is going to occur? Where is this stage? Where is this theater? Well, it is where he is, per verse 24. And he is once again there, speaking of the future as being so inevitable that he has phrased it as present. Thus, he is referring to heaven, the heavenly places. This prayer is not contrived out of thin air, as we said when we entered into it. It is informed by what? It is informed by the upper room discourse that precedes it. And this particular concept is drawn directly from, do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. John 14, 1 through 6. And once again, as we said then, the point of that passage, the point of this passage here in John 17, 24, is not a place, man. It's a person. The primary point of these texts isn't where the disciples and we are going. It is the fact that we are going there with Jesus, and when we get there, we will see him as he truly is. That is why their hearts didn't have to be troubled, because by believing in God and Jesus, they will gain access to the unique dwelling place of God, and Jesus, of course, will be there with him. God's gracious or benevolent presence is uniquely manifest in the heavenly places. God is all places. God is omnipresent. God is in hell. God is on earth. God is in heaven. But he is uniquely present in the heavenly places. message here from Jesus to his 11, and by extension, all of his followers of all time, is by your belief in me, the very dwelling place of God is open to you without reservation. And there you will see me as I truly am. Philippians 2, 5 through 7 speaks of the incarnation when the second person of the Trinity became truly human. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. And every Christmas, I think pretty well all of us sing a hymn that expounds upon that. Christ, by heaven, by highest heaven adored, this is just a couple lines. Christ, the everlasting Lord, late in time, behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb, veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with man to dwell, in Jesus our Emmanuel. Now that veil of which Wesley wrote there was temporal, and he recognized that it was not eternal, or it has been ripped off. In fact, Christ has not been wearing that veil for the last 2,000 years. He is now as he was from all eternity, and that is gloriously unveiled. And this prayer, that is far more a confirmation than a petition, is that this great unified people would all see it. Verse 24, Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, be with me where I am, and that they may see my glory which you have given me. Again, that is the whole point of salvation. It is to make true worshipers who are granted the perception by God of being able to see the glory of God. Because unbelievers cannot see it. They have not eyes to see it. It is hidden from the world, but God has ordained that the eyes of the elect would be opened that they may behold the wonders of God, that they may see what Moses prayed he would be able to see, but was only given a partial view of. We will not see in part. We will see in full. Paul said, no eye has seen and no ear has heard all that God has prepared for those that love him. We have not yet seen, no, but we will. Because every blood-bought saint will have their born-again and glorified eyes opened to the unmitigated glory of Christ. This is unfathomable to me. It really is. This is something so wonderful that I long to see it, and yet I know I could not see it and live. And there, having been perfected, there will be nothing to prevent me. Right now, it would tear me apart. It would mean death. But there I will behold it with eyes of love, and it will be nothing but a comfort to me. Here it would be a terror, because I still carry my flesh with me. There I will behold him as he is, and brother, sister, Christian, you will behold him as he is. And if you want to know how wonderful that is, just consider the eternal state of the saints. This is why they praise him forever, because they are overcome by the radiance of his glory. So my final question then this afternoon is, if you are sitting here and hearing this, will you behold his glory? In a sense, I suppose we all will. But will you see it and behold it in terror right before that great power casts you into everlasting darkness, or will you behold it in wonder? I pray that you'll trust the Lord Jesus today. I pray that you will put your faith in him today. I pray that your eyes will be open to the wonders of the next life in the same way that ours will, and understand that there isn't a person here who thinks that they are going to be in that situation because they're better than you. It has nothing to do with that. Christ is infinitely better than all of us, and he has given his riches to beggars. And I pray that you'll beg him for it today, that he might open your eyes. Heavenly Father, We praise you and we thank you for the consideration of all these things. We thank you that we have a Savior who prays for us. We thank you that we will see his glory. Glory as of the only begotten. We are so grateful for these things. I pray that your people will love each other on account of this more. I pray that they will be diligent to preserve the bond of peace. A foretaste of heaven we can give each other. And we so long for the day when we see you as you are. And praise you and we thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name, amen, Father.